In the study of electricity, there are three main types of materials: conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. In this video, we shall concentrate on semiconductors. Semiconductors are very useful in the application of so many electrical and electronic appliances today. Even the device you are watching this from works on the operation of semiconductors. Before semiconductors, vacuum tubes were used for amplification and switching purposes. But when transistors were invented in the 1940s, they were replaced with vacuum tubes in radios. That made it possible for radios to be downsized down to very small portable devices. Some basic semiconductor devices are integrated circuits, diodes, operational amplifiers, and transistors. Semiconductor devices has helped in so many ways over the years, such as improving automobile safety and treatment in medical care. Some common semiconductor elements are silicon and germanium. Now let's look at the energy band theory. This refers to the phenomenon where electrons in the valence shells gain energy to move to the conduction band. These energies may be thermal, that's heat, or light energy. Energy band can be used to classify insulators, conductors, and semiconductors. For conductors, the valence band and the conduction band overlaps each other. This makes it possible for the least amount of energy to move an electron from the valence band to the conduction band. For semiconductors, the gap between the conduction band and the valence band is very narrow. For that matter, more energy is required to move an electron from the valence band to the conduction band. And for insulators, the gap between the valence band and the conduction band is very wide, which makes it impossible, or even if possible, we need a very large amount of energy to move the electrons from the valence band to the conduction band. Semiconductors can be grouped into two main types, and they are intrinsic semiconductors and extrinsic semiconductors. Intrinsic semiconductors: free electrons from the valence band obtain enough thermal energy to move to the conduction band. These electrons are referred to as free electrons. And when these electrons leave the valence band to the conduction band, they leave behind spaces called holes. Holes are positive charges, whereas electrons carry negative charges. For intrinsic semiconductor devices, the number of holes is equal to the number of electrons. And semiconductors in their pure or intrinsic state cannot conduct electricity well. So how could this be something very useful to the human race? This is where engineers came up with a process called doping. Doping refers to the process of adding impurity elements, such as trivalent or pentavalent elements, to intrinsic semiconductor devices to produce an extrinsic semiconductor device. You should know that trivalent elements are elements that have three valence electrons. They are also referred to as group 3 elements, while pentavalent elements are elements that has 5 valence electrons. They are also referred to as group 5 elements. Now let's look at extrinsic semiconductors. Extrinsic semiconductors are the result of doping an impurity with an intrinsic semiconductor. It can be a p-type or an n-type depending on the kind of impurity used. When a trivalent element is used to dope an intrinsic semiconductor, the resulting extrinsic semiconductor has more holes and hence is called a p-type semiconductor. And when a pentavalent element is used to dope an intrinsic semiconductor, the resulting extrinsic semiconductor has more number of free electrons and hence called n-type semiconductor. Now that we have a p-type and an n-type semiconductor, we can put them together to form a barrier. This barrier is called p-n junction. The p-n junction behaves in a very wonderful way, and I'll let you know. The n side of the p-n junction is called the cathode, and the p-type is called the anode. The small region of their meeting point is called the depletion layer. When a DC power source is applied to the terminals of the p-n junction, this activity or phenomenon is called biasing. There are two types of biasing: forward bias and reverse bias. Forward bias: here, the positive terminal of the source is connected to the anode and the negative terminal is connected to the cathode. When this happens, the depletion layer becomes very narrow, which makes it possible for conduction to take place. And in the reverse bias, the positive terminal of the source is connected to the cathode and the negative terminal is connected to the anode. When this happens, the depletion layer widens, making it difficult for conduction to take place. It is observed that during forward bias, the p-n junction acts as a conductor, and during reverse bias, it acts as an insulator. This phenomenon of the p-n junction is the basis on which all semiconductor devices, such as diodes, transistors, operational amplifiers, and ICs, operate. I believe you've learned something. Please subscribe and share if you haven't subscribed. And if you subscribe, please share so that others get to know about this channel. Thanks for watching.